This project was a bit of a two-in-one. I wanted to make something where the electronics were hidden in plain sight, looked more like a weird sculpture than a piece of electronics, and I wanted a device that let you know when a hot drink had cooled off enough. Because I didn't have much of a plan, very few parts of this project worked on the first try. I thought about editing some of those mistakes out, but then I figured, ah, what the heck, call it a learning experience. Anyway, enjoy a video that I was tempted to call Gavin F**ks Up. To start with, I needed a way to measure the temperature of the drink, and I picked up this infrared temperature sensor from Adafruit. You can think of this kind of like a single pixel infrared camera, except instead of measuring the temperature along a single straight line, it picks up everything in a 90 degree cone starting at the sensor. I got this for a few reasons. First, I knew I wanted a contactless way to measure the temperature so I wouldn't have to worry about anything making the water unsafe to drink or that needed to be cleaned too often. And since one of my goals with this project was to make something that looked more like a sculpture than a piece of electronics, this was definitely the coolest looking module I could find. Most of the sensors I found had chips attached and just generally looked pretty ugly, but this Adafruit one gave off kind of a cool Sputnik vibe, so it was a pretty easy choice. It's an easy module to use too, it's just got four wires coming off, two for power and two for data, that a microcontroller can use to read the temperature. Here's the final circuit. I powered it with a 9-volt battery so I wouldn't have an exposed power cable, and even though 9-volt batteries don't last that long, I thought it'd be easier to mount than multiple AA or AAA batteries, and the battery I'm using is rechargeable anyway. I added a switch that will need to somehow be mounted underneath the coaster so it magically turns on when you put a cup down without wasting power when it's not being used. The switch turns on an Arduino Nano that reads the temperature from the sensor and turns on between 1 and 5 LEDs depending on how hot it is. The temperature range of the LEDs is configurable in the code, and I have it turned way down for testing so my body heats enough to trigger all the LEDs, but it'll be turned up later. If you're wondering what temperature scale it's measuring in, I've set up the code so you can measure in all sorts of units, including some I've never heard of. I'm measuring mine in Kelvin because science, but if you want to know how hot Newton or any of these guys would have told you your drink is, you're more than welcome. The part of this project I was the most unsure about was how to suspend the sensor over the drink, so I put that off as long as possible and worked on the base first. I wanted it to be as simple and small as possible so it would look as little like it's hiding electronics as it could, so I went with basically a rectangular box with sides just small enough to fit the battery and a thin piece of wood as the top. I also cut out another piece of wood to use as a backing so the frame that holds up the sensor would have more to drill into than the thin top piece. It's almost as thick as the sides, but with a little room left over for wires or something to stick out without hitting the ground. Also, for those of you with more informal workshops, consider putting something down before cutting wood over your carpet. The trickiest part about the base was deciding how to mount the LEDs. Since I knew I wanted the frame that holds the sensor to be made of brass, I thought maybe embedding a strip of brass on the front side of the base with the LEDs mounted from behind would look pretty nice. Maybe it would've, I'll never know because apparently hand drilling holes in brass that need to be perfectly centered is really hard. I'm actually pretty happy that the first idea flopped since I'm much happier with this next one. I thought, since I want to hide the electronics as much as possible, it'd be pretty cool if you couldn't even see the LEDs when the circuit was turned off. For that, I took the front piece of the base and drilled holes for the LEDs, not all the way through, but as close as I could get so the light would show through the wood. This took quite a few tries, getting more and more nerve-wracking each time, since if I accidentally went all the way through, I'd have to start over. But eventually, I drilled and chiseled enough for the piece of wood to fit snugly on the LEDs with a thin enough wall that the light shone through. I'm really happy with how this turned out, but a drill press has definitely moved higher up on my wish list. The next step was figuring out how to turn everything on when a mug is placed on the coaster. That meant I had to hide a switch underneath, and to keep the coaster from rocking back and forth too much, I needed it to be as flush as possible with the surface of the wood. I figured I'd cut a coaster-sized hole out of the top of the base and add another piece of wood as backing, so the coaster would be recessed into the surface a bit since I figured that'd look a little better. I also 3D printed a little part to hold the switch and cut out a hole in the wood to fit it. Unfortunately, I don't have a bandsaw or anything, so I had to try cutting the coaster hole in the top section by hand using a coping saw. They make special saws called hole saws that fit into your drill that make this really easy, but there's no way I was gonna go spend like 50 bucks on a special tool I'd only use once, plus this doesn't seem too hard, it's just a circle. So I accidentally cut up one of my clamps, but whatever, it'll still work, and I have a totally perfect, definitely not awful circle cutout, no hole saw needed. Sure, it's a little rough, but maybe instead of a wood backing, I'll 3D print one. It has a bit of a lip, so it covers the edge and you won't be able to tell. Okay, so it doesn't quite fit, and the hole needs to be a bit bigger, but that's nothing a chisel can't fix. This is going to be totally fine. There, that looks big enough. Time to do a test fit. Might need a little elbow grease to get it in, because it's kind of a snug fit, but that's just going to... This is a hole saw. If you want to cut a perfect large diameter hole in a piece of wood, this is the tool for you. Inexperienced people might be tempted to try and cut it by hand, but that would just be silly. There, a perfect coaster-sized hole. Okay, so I went to put the sides on and the hole's technically a bit off-center, but it's close enough that I can't tell when I'm looking at it and I'm out of wood for the top piece anyway, so I'm just gonna get a little bit creative here. It turns out I like the look of the 3D printed insert better than the wood backing anyway, so I'm gonna keep that and give it a paint job so it matches the coaster. That's the coaster bit done. It works really well, especially since I glued a thin piece of scrap wood to the back of the coaster to give it a bit more rigidity, since it's made of rubber and it was bending a bit too much and getting stuck when the switch was pressed down. I might replace that later with a properly shaped piece of wood, but it's working fine for now. That was the last piece of the body to figure out. Now we just need to glue it all together. I just did this with standard wood glue and clamped everything together to dry overnight. The bulk of the clamping was done with these awesome, I think they're called trigger clamps, which I've seen around for years but somehow never used before. I picked them up when I was buying the hole saw since they were on sale, and man are they awesome. I've historically used the kind where you have to screw the handle to do the final bit of tightening, and these are just so much better. This is just a PSA for anybody else who's never actually used them before. I'll put a link in the description for these, but I've seen tons of brands with similar products, and I'd be willing to bet that they're pretty much all the same. Anyway, back to gluing. I needed to mount the battery underneath so that it's easily removable, but I didn't want to try and fit a proper 9-volt battery holder, so I just glued the backing plate in place while it was pushed up tightly against the battery. This made it a nice press fit holding the battery in place, and I can take it in and out really easily by hand, but it's not going to fall out on its own. When everything was dry, I added a few coats of polyurethane for some protection and a nice finish, and the body was done. Which unfortunately meant I couldn't put off the brass part any longer. I didn't really have a plan for this, other than that I wanted it to be made of brass. My first attempt was to make something like wire tentacles, which in my head could just be coils of wire reaching up to hold the sensor in place. I tried spiraling them by hand, and when that wasn't working, I tried using some scrap PVC. Turns out a spiral of wire is just a spring, and it's not something that'd ever be able to hold something up without flopping all over the place. To try to solve that problem, I went out and bought a bunch of thin balsa wood circles. I thought instead of having four springy tentacles, I could have one bigger one with slices of wood every so often to keep it more rigid, twisted into kind of a helix. The added benefit of this is that the wood acts as a spacer to prevent the four wires from touching, since because they're going to be used for actually connecting the sensor to the Arduino, they would short if they touched. I straightened the wire out with a drill, which kind of worked, and then drilled a bunch of holes in increasingly small circles of wood, ran the wires through the holes, and tried to twist each piece to make some kind of interesting spiral. This was a bit closer, kind of a whimsical Dr. Seuss look, but it was still too floppy to be useful, and frankly, I don't think it looked very good. Once again, I'm actually glad my first attempts failed, since I'm much happier with how it ended up turning out. I bought some 2mm brass rods and drew a neat pattern on a piece of paper, sized so that it'd fit where it needed to be. I scrubbed them with steel wool to get rid of any coating they might have had, and then cut pieces to size and taped them to the drawing. Then I just cranked up the heat on my soldering iron and soldered the joints with normal solder, although a little more generously than normal. It took a while since the brass is slow to heat up since it's so thick, but it worked great. I did that 3 more times, and then I had a nice looking and definitely not floppy structure. I drilled some holes into the wood base to hold them in place, making sure to go all the way through on the long legs so that I could solder wires to them from the bottom. The result again showed that I should really get myself a drill press, but overall the effect was pretty good. With all the hard parts figured out, all that was left was some soldering and final assembly. We'll be right back. I soldered this stupid coaster switch in without putting it through the base first. So now it's stuck on one side and I can't get it in. That's it. I'm super pleased with how this turned out. It works great, although it definitely took a lot longer than I'd expected. I actually started this midway through another larger project since I was 3D printing some parts that were going to take days and days to finish, and I thought I could squeeze a smaller project in while I was waiting, but those were done long before this was finished. Anyway, as usual, links to the code, materials, and a circuit diagram are in the description. Hope you enjoyed, and see you next time.